It's Friday, March 22nd, 2024. It's the end of the last day of the first week. Well, actually, not the last day, because they're going to work on Saturday and they're going to work on Sunday. But it's we've had about a week of negotiations on the pandemic treaty at the World Health Organization. And I'm here with Alexandra. And Alexandra, I'd like you to introduce yourself, tell people who you represent, why you're here, and what you think is going on so far.
So my name's Alexandra Phelan. I'm an associate professor at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health and a senior scholar at the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security. I'm here as kind of two hats, really, is as an academic. We have a research project funded by the National Science Foundation to examine the negotiations and look how the negotiations are progressing with key elements that are being discussed and how it relates to science. And also as a representative of Johns Hopkins University and the Center for Health Security. In terms of how the negotiations are progressing, I think what was surprising is that there'd been quite a lot of pessimism on the first couple of days. It was palpable. There was a lot of frustration in the room. And whilst there were commitments to good faith reaching this negotiation and reaching an agreement, it was quite clear that member states were coming to sort of a bit of a tipping point. I think over the last couple of days, it's been interesting to see how that's shifted. There's a little bit more optimism in the room. There's been a bit of progress and momentum being made. But I think it'll be still a heavy lift to reach agreement in time for the May 2024 Health Assembly. But there does seem to be a genuine commitment to trying to still reach agreement in the room generally.
What part of the agreement are you really focusing on yourself?
Yeah, so I think the first, as a lawyer, as an international lawyer, one of my interest areas is the definitions. So really interested in how the scope of the agreement is going to be set. And that's often something that's left to the very end, is going back to use of terms and looking at the definitions at the end. So how is pandemic defined? How does this relate to the international health regulations? Under what part of the WHO constitution will this agreement be adopted? They're all international legal questions that I find really interesting. From a sort of scientific angle, I'm really particularly interested in the operation of the pathogen access and benefits sharing system, how that has developed lessons from other areas of international law, and its potential to realize equity or potentially even science for science.
Do you think there's a conflict between the benefit sharing aspect of the PABS and access to knowledge behalf of the researchers?
So I don't see a conflict, and that's where we come to this idea of science for science. And that's a term that came out of a paper that we published in Nature with nearly 300 scientists signing on from around the world. And I think starting point is that the status quo is not that sequences and samples are shared freely and open source and without restriction. There are a lot of pressures on whether sharing is occurring, including from national government pressures, from technical capacities, from publishing pressures, and even the operation of other areas of international law, like biodiversity law. And so we do need to really work to create a much better free-flowing access regime for pathogen samples and sequences. So I think first thing is not thinking that the status quo is actually working well. Then from the benefits sharing, I think we all know from the COVID-19 pandemic and before how inequitable access to vaccines, diagnostics, therapeutics and pandemic products produced from pathogen samples and sequences has been. So I won't belabor that point. But I think the one thing that comes up is why these things are interconnected. And I think the starting point is to actually look at a bit of international legal history without going too into the weeds. The decolonization movement in the 50s and 60s really saw states around the world asserting their own sovereignty and independence from colonial powers. And part of that assertion of sovereignty was recognizing that the control over genetic resources was a key part of that independence movement, that things weren't being extracted and taken to colonial powers. And so really when we think about the Convention on Biological Diversity, One of its objectives is the preservation of biodiversity, but it also has other objectives, and those other objectives are the equitable sharing of benefits that arise from the use of genetic resources because of that colonial history. And so because of that, there has been an inherent linkage between access and benefits sharing that is echoed through international law over decades. And if we think about access and benefit sharing as a way of achieving equity, as a way of realising that independence, is I think one way to start thinking about access and benefit sharing, a slightly different angle and a different light.
To what extent are pathogens considered biologic resources under the Convention on Biologic Diversity?
Yeah, so under the definitions of genetic resources, it includes plant, animal, and microbial origin, genetic resources of microbial origin. And I think it's important to remember that microbial origin is broader than pathogens. Pathogens are a subset of microbes, and there are microbes that have beneficial uses. There are microbes that that we use within scientific research and for medicines that have a range of positive uses as well. And sometimes you can have a microbe that may have both pathogenic and non-pathogenic benefits. So there's kind of a catch-all in that definition to include microbial agents. A number of countries around the world have included in their legislation pathogens. Some have implied the inclusion of pathogens in their legislation, and so there really is a critical mass of countries around the world that do see that linkage between the development of vaccines, diagnostics and therapeutics is so dependent upon the sequence data and samples from pathogens that you kind of have that interlinkage through.
Do you know, I mean, I'm sorry that sun's now in your eyes here. Can you describe, or is it, something you want to talk about the positions of different regions or governments? I mean, like, which governments are taking which positions on these issues?
Yeah, so, I mean, when it comes to PABS, there is, because of this history around access and benefit sharing, you do see a divergence between the global north and the global south, with the global south seeing an access and benefit sharing regime as one tool for realising equity. I think it's commonly stated that the Global North has a particular anti-ABS position. That's not the case nowadays. It may be the case 5-10 years ago. I think there is a recognition of some of this history. There's a recognition of the neatness of the mechanism and as that underpinning bargain. And I think as our piece in Nature showed, scientists around the world are really committed to equitable benefits sharing. That is, building capacity for scientists in the global south, translation of learnings horizontally between the global south or between the global north, and the fact that science for science is potentially one of the ways this mechanism could be realised. So I think the divide can be a little bit artificial. But there's certainly interest groups on either side that are sort of affecting where countries are sitting on these issues.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if you're familiar with it or not, but we are, we are not keen in terms of our organizations on the idea of limitations on access to sequence information.
Yeah, so I think there are ways to structure that facilitates as open as possible sharing and thinking about benefit sharing in innovative ways, and so not necessarily seeing that you have to have a very rigid access for benefit sharing, but thinking about multilateral benefit sharing, thinking about creating databases that facilitate access. And I think the point really to reiterate is the status quo is not the sequences are shared as openly and as accessibly as I think it's often made out to be. The governance of a number of databases is not transparent. It's not accountable who can actually have access or gain access to these databases. There are a lot of ad hoc informal networks for sharing, And I think what's really important is that we do keep open the sort of sharing that we need for surveillance, and having those obligations for sharing as open as possible, but thinking innovatively about how we can have multilateral benefits sharing in a way that supports and enhances rapid sample and sequence sharing.
What is your feeling on the use of sequences and training data for artificial intelligence?
So it's an interesting point. We actually have a paper looking at zoonotic risk prediction and the role of AI. I think it's not my particular area of expertise, so I should highlight that from a technical standpoint. I do think that any system or any process that essentially generates new sequences does raise potential issues with this dynamic and with thinking about multilateral benefits sharing. But one of the things that we examined in that paper was thinking about who is informing those algorithms, who has access to those algorithms, how are the benefits from those algorithms shared. So thinking also about equity in actual technology and access to that technology as well is important.
Are you familiar with the concept of data spaces?
I'm not, no.
It's a notion that there'd be a decentralized management control of data, but allowing researchers to run queries across multiple databases, not getting the data, but getting the results of the query, allowing the local control of the privacy and other parts of managing the data. A lot of it, I think, has come about in the medical area around the privacy issue. But you see a lot of discussion now about data, about localization of data, and whether you want it all centralized in different places. I don't want to press you on this, because obviously it's kind of an obscure area I was not really too familiar with myself until recently.
Yeah, I'll definitely look into it more. Yeah.
Listen, you've been great about doing this whole interview while the sun changed and is burning into your eyes. Is there anything that you'd say at last thing before I turn the video off?
I think, as I said before, is the status quo is one that, not just PABS, but more broadly, the status quo is one where we're actually in a much more vulnerable position now than we were in 2019. We have exhausted healthcare systems. We have fragmented surveillance systems. We have not necessarily open and freely accessible access to samples and sequences. And we have fundamentally the inequitable sharing of vaccines, diagnostics, and therapeutics. We need international cooperation on this issue, and it is urgent. We have a number of different pathogens that could be the next pandemic. And with climate change and other ecological factors, the pressure on the potential of a next pandemic is only increasing. This international cooperation and collaboration is vital, and I think international law plays a really important part in solidifying that, and then creating the systems where we can build the norms and build the trust that are necessary for cooperation for the next pandemic. And that's an urgent task that's on the negotiators inside here. And that would be my message to them.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.